I'd like to call the regular meeting of the Board of Trustees of July 28th, 2009 to order. Please join the board and myself in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Clerk Pruce, would you please call the roll?
Trustee Actipius?
Present.
Trustee Carson?
Here.
Trustee Moore?
Here.
Trustee Syed? Trustee Woolen?
Present.
Trustee Zanis?
Here.
And President Craig?
Here. We're going to be removing items 10A2 and then 10G from tonight's agenda. Madam Clerk, are there any members of the public who wish to address the board at this time?
Yes. The first person is Nellie Navrad.
McGee.
Lane, could you take... I'm sorry.
Good evening. I'm sorry I cannot get to the podium. I'm having some complication from a car accident in my leg. My name is Nellie Najib, and I'm here this evening before you on behalf of the Oak Brook Civic Association. I would like to ask, please, everybody to help us out, send in their dues, which is $45 to the association. We are in a tight budget. We have an annual calendar we are supposed to be printing the next couple of weeks, and then we need sponsors to be able to print this annual calendar that goes to all residents of Oak Brook. I would like to thank Trustee Elaine Zanies, who committed a sponsor ad in our calendar for $2,500. Also Bradford and Kent. We are seeking more sponsors, please, because the cost will be about $12,000 that we do send to all Oak Brook residents. So that's why I'm here this evening to ask you to please, if you can sponsor the calendar, we will appreciate it. You will receive a newsletter informing all the details about it. Also, I would like to ask everyone in Oak Brook, every household, to please be involved in the Oak Brook Civic Association. It's a very good organization, and then we serve everybody in Oak Brook. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Najib. Is there another?
Bill Linderman.
I don't think that's working. Maybe you have to hold the
thing. I know, every meeting it's...
I'm sorry.
I would like to make a brief comment now and then hold my additional comments until the issue of zoning requests by McDonald's Corporation becomes a topic. I placed some materials on the positions at the... board table here this evening. I'm running out of time in preparing the materials I had hoped to present, but I guess I'm upset over the lack of continuity between McDonald's plans and considering the great expense that the village is placing upon its residents to effect a widening and beautification of the 22nd Street corridor. I think there's a serious conflict there, and I don't think it's been adequately addressed because of the lack of information provided by McDonald's company to the Zoning Board of Appeals. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Linderman. Madam Clerk, are there any?
Renton Daly.
Madam Clerk, I signed on that form to discuss McDonald's zoning under number 8. That's the only reason I'm on there, so I'm on record when that issue does come up.
Okay, we'll keep that in mind.
Okay. Mike Van Zandik.
Like the other gentleman, I'm here in connection with the referral of the Oak Brook Promenade request for zoning text change that is on the agenda.
Okay. Thank you.
Hey, Richard Dickinson.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak, folks. My name is Richard Dickinson. I've either lived or worked in Oak Brook for over 20 years now. I've had extensive experience and contact with several different departments within the city, and I'm concerned by two things. For starters, the cuts that have apparently become permanent with regard to some of the city staff. I think it's critically important for the village to make sure that they do maintain proper fire and police protection throughout the 24-hour period of every given day. Furthermore, with the extent that I've had, I just wanted to go on record as saying that the city staff has been exceptional in all of my dealings with them. They're very committed people. They work very, very hard. And contrary to some of the articles that have recently been published in the doings, I don't necessarily think that anybody goes into public service at the municipal level with integrity and honesty with the intention of becoming wealthy. I just wanted to make sure that they knew that I appreciate their work. I appreciated their work on the day that my grandmother passed away. And Officers Lesko was there for us. Also the time that she had a spell and the paramedics were there almost instantaneously. And then with running our business, the building department and planning and zoning has been absolutely fantastic. And I truly appreciate your service, but I also wanted to make sure that the city and the residents understand that these are very hardworking people and they deserve our appreciation. Thank you.
Thank you.
May I?
Oh, go ahead.
Comment? Yes. We certainly appreciate your comments, sir, and I want to assure you, and I'm sure every other board member feels exactly the way I do, that the process we went through was a painful one for us. No one enjoys the fallout that comes out of some people losing their jobs. It was a difficult process, but I think we have a responsibility to, we realize that we have a responsibility to the residents of this community to make certain that that we move forward to take whatever steps are necessary to protect the financial condition of the community. And what I want to add is, just as much as you do, we are certainly very impressed by the quality of our staff. We don't believe that our staff has gone into those positions of service because of the money involved. We realize that there is a commitment from them to serve as well as we do. And I have nothing but the highest praise for our staff. But we did have to take some steps to really bring our budget under control.
And just to add to Trustee Actipa's comments, we actually, none of the layoffs that occurred in police and fire, but I do appreciate your comments, and I agree there's been way too much negative stuff about the staff. The staff is really the one that's now going to have to work a lot harder because of some of these positions being vacant. So it's good to hear those positive comments. Thank you.
Madam Clerk, are there any others?
No, that's it.
Thank you. Before we leave that item, I do wish that someone someday will get up to that microphone and tell us what they would do to help us with the budget. I mean, it's great to throw bombs and rocks and everything at what we try to do. Believe me, we are up against a very difficult time, and I'm sure most of you are tired of hearing about this. But we have no local levy for the library, for the public works, for the fire department, for the police department. We don't levy a tax in Oak Brook. And to be quite candid with you, unless we do cutting or we come up with some innovative ways to make money, our sales tax is going south. We're not getting the same results we did 2, 3, 4, 10, 15 years ago. That's not there. And I'd love for somebody to come up just once and say, hey, you're on the right track, but you can do this and do it better. That's great. This is the kind of remarks I really would appreciate. I think unless you're up again, Mr. Lindemann, is this when you wanted to talk for the second time?
I wanted to answer your prayer.
Let's hear what the answer to my prayer is.
Having been an employee for 27 years of the village prior to my retirement,
as a fireman.
I think if you review the retirement records of the police and fire, mm-hmm. and the reasons for the retirement, the number of on-duty injuries, and the cause of those on-duty injuries, they're not really job-related. They're related to a lack of understanding how to do things safely. And at some point, I'd like to get together with someone, and it would help the people that work for the village, and it would help control future losses of people that are physically able but become incapacitated because they're not aware of safe procedures.
That would be great, Bill, if you could come up and tell the whole board and the public about it. I'd love to hear it. But not tonight.
It's something right. It's something that has to be brought out, and it requires some research, but there's great potential there.
Thank you. The next item is the approval of minutes, a regular Board of Trustees meeting of July 14th. May I have a motion for the approval of minutes from the meeting of July 14th?
I will so move.
I'll second.
With a correction, on page 2 of the minutes, Madam Clerk, second line from the top, you referred to expense cuts for 2009 by approximately $250,000. That was $750,000. And in line 4, you report that the recommendation included approximately $1.1 million, but actually the correct number would be approximately $1.25 million. Other than that, no other changes.
I second.
May I have a roll call vote, please?
Trustee Actipus?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is the consent agenda, and I'm going to ask Clerk Pruce if she would please go through the consent agenda at this time.
All items on the consent agenda are considered to be routine in nature and will be enacted in one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a board member so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered as the first item after approval of the consent agenda. Accounts payable for pay period ending July 24, 2009, $744,798.43. Significant items included in above. 1, legal bills. A, Olstein & Sturck, LTD, legal services regarding Mucha case for June 2009 in the amount of $832.50. B, Olstein & Sturck, LTD, legal services for June 2009 in the amount of $30,080.66. C, Irvis, Condon and Persini, legal services for May and June 2009 in the amount of $641.86. D, Bavis, Condon and Persini, legal services for June 2009 in the amount of $1,673. 2, DuPage Water Commission, June 30th, 2009, $187,641.50. B, Approval of payroll for pay period ending July 11, 2009, $840,017.03. C. Community development referrals. Referral NAI Hiffman, Oprah Promelade, text amendment, zoning ordinance section 13-7A-1. D. Authorization to seek bids or proposals or negotiate contracts, none presented. E. Budget adjustments. 1. Sports score, polo, sponsorship, revenue. 2. ITS information services, consulting services. F. Ordinance and resolutions, none presented. G. Treasurer's report, June 30th, 2009. H. Hire police sergeant. I. Callahan contract, bath and tennis clubhouse.
Thank you.
That's the end of the consent.
Does any board member wish to have any item removed from the consent agenda? Yes, Trustee Moy.
Thank you, President Craig. Item C1, the NAI Hiffman.
Okay. Any others? Yes.
Yes, item 6H.
Ms. Sargent.
And I would like to remove item 6I.
So it's 6I, 6H, and 6C.
61.
I'm sorry? Correct. Why don't we start with Trustee Moy?
Thank you, President Craig.
Oh, okay. May have a motion to approve the consent agenda and authorize the expenditures as presented or amended.
So moved.
Second.
And at the discussion at this time, Trustee Moy.
You didn't vote on the consent agenda.
Oh, you want to vote on the consent agenda
those
now?
Three items.
All right, we're going to vote on the consent agenda at this time.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Ektepis?
Yes.
Now go to the referral.
Okay, that carries.
Now we go to this one.
All right, the first one on our list is 6C. That is the referral, the community development referrals. NI Hiffman, Trustee Moy.
Thank you, President Craig. The item concerns Hiffman, where they're thinking of allowing a beauty school to rent space at the promenade. In view of the problems that are presently ongoing at the promenade, I understand that Go Roma is closing its doors. Robin Brothers Jewelers,
yes,
is closing or has closed.
Yes.
And then another dress shop, I don't know the name of, has closed. And I think the only concern of the board is if this beauty school takes up first floor space that could be used for retail that could generate sales tax, I would have a problem with that. If they go up to a second level in one of the offices, I think that would be more acceptable. Is there a representative from Hiffman here?
May I make some additional comments?
Yeah. Since you will be addressing those, if we decide to move this forward and pass it on to the Plan Commission and the Zoning Board of Appeals to deal with it, I think in addition to the concerns that Trustee Moy expressed, I also would like to see the Zoning Board of Appeals and the Plan Commission put a limit to the percent of the space that can be leased to users that do not produce sales taxes, so that this is not an open invitation to see the entire second floor of that property become unproductive in terms of the village, essentially because this is an area where the village has made major concessions through the approval of a TIF. And for that reason, I think we should have a closer overseeing of how this property is properly used.
Attorney Sterk, how would you address that?
Well, if they want to send it back to the you know, for some amendments to the, if they had a public hearing on this already?
No. No, there was no public hearing yet. It is here in front of us today to be referred to the. To
and it's got to, if you're going to, so it requires a text amendment, you're going to have to send it back, and you can send it back with those comments.
Okay.
That that's what you're looking for.
The application does refer to the use.
Would you please announce your name again and your...
Sure. I'm Mike Van Zandt. I'm part of the Oak Brook Promenade LLC. And your comments are accurate. They are not within our control to... Robbins declared Chapter 11 bankruptcy, rejected the lease. There's nothing that, that we can do about that. And Goroma did just close their store last Friday. That's
if you take the microphone, please, and because you're not coming through to some people.
Okay. As to the application, the request for the text exchange text amendment does include the fact that this particular use was is being considered for the second floor.
Very good. I think we could move forward and send that on to the to our commissions with a recommendation that they would look also to a certain amount of limitation as to how much of the second floor space could be leased to a non-tax producing.
As long as you're here, what are the prospects of bringing new business to replace the ones who have closed the doors? I know it's a tough economic times, but any prospects on the horizon?
We do have a number of prospects, more so than we had at the in the early part of this year, not surprisingly. I guess that's how I could answer it. You know, there's nothing that's that I'd characterize as imminent, but certainly encouraging.
Does anyone have any questions?
I have a motion.
Surely.
A motion is to refer the matter to the appropriate boards with the recommendation that it will that it should also look at limiting the amount of space that can be devoted to non-sales tax producing businesses.
Second.
May a roll call vote, please.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Wolin?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Aktipas?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Motion carries. Thank you. The next item is hiring a police sergeant. Was that it? H6H?
Trustee Wolin.
Oh. I'm sorry?
Trustee Wolin.
Yeah, all right. Trustee Wolin.
Yeah, the intent of this a recommendation here is to provide direction to the village manager on whether he should ask the Board of Fire and Police to appoint a police sergeant from their current list. And I'm going to recommend that we do not make the appointment at this point in time. The reason that we need board approval is because this was not a budgeted item. And it was not budgeted because in earlier attempts to save money, that was decided that this was one area that we could get by without filling. And we are in the process, as we said many times over the past meetings, of reviewing every single department. You know, we're reviewing the library. We've had many discussions on that. Later on tonight, we're going to be talking about a contract to review the fire department. We are also talking, and may talk about it later tonight, doing a review of the police department. I think the appropriate thing to do is conduct the review of the police department before we make a decision to promote somebody to sergeant. Because once you make a promotion, it's pretty hard to take it back. And at this point in time, until we have that review, we really don't know what the organizational structure should look like. The other thing is, my understanding, and if I'm wrong, I'll stand corrected, my understanding is the intent is that this sergeant would work for Lieutenant Shuey in the investigative unit, where Lieutenant Shuey directs three people, three officers. And I have trouble understanding why you need a lieutenant and a sergeant to manage three people. If additional manpower is needed in that department, certainly move a patrolman there. But I think it's inappropriate to promote somebody to sergeant at this point in time. And what I'm going to recommend, I'm not going to do it now because if I'm going to recommend later that we table it until we do the review of the police department. I'm not going to make that motion now, because if I make it and there's a second, that kind of ends debate, and I think it's important that we do have debate.
At this point, I think it might be good to hear from the department head. May I hear from the police chief?
Thank you, President Craig, and board members. The issue here is the promotion of a patrol officer to the rank of sergeant. First and foremost, let me explain to the board how somebody gets promoted to the rank of sergeant. Our patrol officers take a written examination. They're evaluated by the command staff. They then, and by the way, the written examination is overseen by the independent board of police and fire. They're evaluated by the command staff, their work ethic, the way they carry themselves, their productivity, their education, their training. Then our board brings in an outside evaluator, and the patrol officers are run through a battery of tests. These outside evaluators have no connection with the police department at all. As a matter of fact, in the last two tests, I still don't know who did our outside evaluation, but they were chosen by the Board of Police and Fire. After all that's done, a list is made up that includes their education, their seniority, and the various testing items that we talked about. And if an individual is lucky enough to be in the top three, if a vacancy occurs, then they're again reviewed by the Board of Police and Fire, and a recommendation is made. As I read this summary, the way I understood the 2009 budget, we did hold two vacancies in the 2009 budget. It's my understanding we held them as the rank of patrolman. What really happened was a lieutenant retired, and Sergeant Shuey became a lieutenant, and then we looked to now to fill that vacancy. And I think if we look at the budget item, I believe that's correct. In terms of of the officer's responsibility, if whoever is made sergeant, I'll decide who becomes a detective sergeant, and it will not be this individual immediately, because they have to do some work on the road. In terms of who this person supervises, we have four detectives. We have two tactical officers in our police department. We have one sergeant, we have one lieutenant. If the board remembers, we did a reorganization here that was approved by the board and vetted publicly several years ago. I restructured this police department in an effort to make it more streamlined and more effective. Our detectives and our tactical officers spend an inordinate amount of time at our mall, making sure it's safe, making sure our restaurants are safe, making sure our shops are safe, making sure our hotels and the parking venues around there are safe. I changed that structure when we did the restructuring to go from really a 5-day a week to a 7-day a week coverage. I think it's been said many times here that our commercial district pays for the police and pays for the fire and pays for public works and pays for the library. I don't need to explain to the board what would happen if we had crime in our area and there were safety concerns about people coming to shop, stay in our hotels, eat in our fine restaurants. So I shifted some of the responsibility from patrol to our tactical and detective units to maintain a 7-day a week coverage here. Trustee Wolin is correct, and now there is only three detectives in there, and I'll tell you why. We have the two vacancies that I described earlier. We have two officers that are on medical leave. We have four officers, three of whom were injured by outside forces protecting our mall and our hotels and our restaurants, and I mean physically injured. So this sergeant would supervise some tactical and some detective work. And I think it's important to know, I think maybe the board remembers just a few months ago, we recovered $55,000 worth of property in California that was stolen from our mall. Our Detective Sergeant Shuey had contacts with officers outside our community, and we were able to track down a theft from our mall that ended up in California. We recovered the property. That was done on a Saturday night at about 11 o'clock at night. And to her credit, Detective Sergeant Shuey is now Lieutenant Shuey for various other reasons. But in my opinion, to send our officers into the busiest area on the busiest nights in the most serious times when it's demonstrated that other officers have been injured without supervision and without making this a 7-day-a-week battle, I think it would be remiss if not if I said that would be okay. And the board has been very good to us, and I think the police department has cooperated 100% with the village manager and the difficult situation that we're in. But I feel when some of our tactical officers, our younger officers, if they need some guidance and they need some help, I think a sergeant needs to be there or a lieutenant 7 days a week. And I think this is an integral part of our police department. I think it's one of the most important jobs in the police department because I worked it myself as a detective commander. I know and I understand the job. I know and I understand the responsibilities. And I would hope that the board would move to make this promotion tonight. Thank you.
Trustee, thank you, Chief. Trustee Aktipas.
I would like first to clarify that I believe that that Trustee Wallen always takes a very thoughtful approach, and he always invests a lot of time and effort in thinking about issues and. Generally speaking, over the few months that we've been serving together, we have fallen on the same side of an issue. And certainly he's making some good points tonight as well, as he always does. However, there are some other issues that we need to consider before making a decision on this proposal. We, as a board, have not made any cuts. We have not demanded any cuts from either the fire department or the police department or the library, certainly since we became a new board. But we have found that both the police department and the fire department voluntarily present us with some opportunities to achieve some savings. And as Jerry pointed out, we are planning to pursue additional information as to how we can improve efficiencies in those two departments through the use of consultants, because we as a board and our manager, certainly we don't have great expertise in the three important areas. One is the library and the other is the area of public safety, fire and police. So it is indeed true that some of this work remains to be done, and it will take some time to do it. And at the end of the line, hopefully, we'll get some additional savings and some additional trimming of the budget from those departments, if indeed consultants can point out a way that we can do that by increasing efficiency of operations, but without decreasing service to our community. Now, in the interim, I would be remiss, I think, as a trustee, and I believe our board would be remiss if it were to ignore the request of the police chief. He certainly is one that knows better than any one of us does what he absolutely needs in his department to be able to operate in a way that ensures public safety. And I, for one, wouldn't want to double guess him. I wouldn't want to be operating at a very, very, very intense level of micromanagement by not approving a request that the police chief has made based on a good reasoning, which I think you all observed when he made his presentation.
Thank you, Trustee Antipas. Yes, Trustee Carson.
Yes, thank you, President Craig. For the sake of time, I won't repeat something that's already been said, but I do certainly respect Tom's judgment on things. However, I think I have to agree with Trustee Wolin at this time because of the most recent events and things that we've had to do and things that we plan to do that look at both the police and fire more critically with, possibly consultants. And so at this time, I think the timing is absolutely wrong.
Any other opinions? Yes, Trustee Zanis.
Yes, thank you very much. A couple of things. One is certainly Chief Sheehan knows that the consultant is around the corner and that he would have to defend his organization. And so for him to ask for this to be done now, he must feel very confident that he can defend that. And so I agree, I don't think we should micromanage that. Additionally, the $20,000 is per year. So between now and the end of the year, we're not talking about a whole lot of money. And the impact that it will have on the organization far exceeds the cost that we're talking about. So I think we show support for our police chief. I think we show support for his judgment of his organization. And let the consultant come.
Mr. President, I'll move that the request of Police Chief Sheehan is approved.
All right. Do I have a second? I'm calling the question. No, you had your opportunity. I'm sorry. Do I have a second?
So moved.
We have a roll call vote, please.
Trustee Wolin.
No.
Trustee Zanis.
Yes.
Trustee Aktipas.
Yes.
Trustee Carson.
No.
Trustee Moy.
Yes.
The mayor's going to have to vote because it's 3-2.
Okay, and my vote is yes. Thank you. The next item will be Callahan and Associates.
Yes, thank you very much. This is the last of many motions that will culminate in the outsourcing of the Bath and Tennis Clubhouse. At the last Village Board meeting, this board authorized the staff to negotiate a contract with Callahan Catering. Myself, along with Attorney Stirk, Trey Van Dyke, former trustee Kathy Manofsky, Dave Niemeyer, village manager, and representatives from Callahan met on three separate occasions, and we have reached agreement on major points. That agreement is attached, and I'm just going to highlight a few things for our residents. The agreement begins October 18th, 2009. That will be officially the end of the wedding season that we will cater. And it will end January 1st, 2011, in hopes that we will have a New Year's Eve celebration that day before. Callahan will begin receiving phone calls to take bookings for events at the Bath and Tennis August 1st. Although unofficially, they have taken a few calls. So that's very positive. And there is marketing staff at Callahan to manage this. We have the proposed marketing plan attached for your review. The Article 2 outlines user fees which will be charged. And those user fees range, this is now rent for the room, ranges from $500 Monday through Thursday during the day and goes as high as $2,500 on Saturday evenings for a major event. The best part about this is that we have a reached agreement that Callahan will pay a minimum of $100,000 in user fees and 10% of the food and beverage costs. So if they do not book enough to cover that $100,000 commitment, they will write a check to the Village of Oak Brook to compensate for it. But they're hoping to do far, far better than that. And, of course, we have the deferral of all of the overhead and staff and catering costs. Let's see, what else? Callahan will host two open houses. One will be for Oak Brook residents and businesses. That will be held on September 17th. A formal mailing will go out. They will absorb the cost of the entire event, including the printing of the invitation. Our contribution will be postage for that event. And then they will hold a second big marketing event in the spring for the bridal season. And then to ensure that we stay on track throughout the next 12 months, that group that has met already will continue to meet once every 2 months to review the operations and make sure that we stay focused on our marketing and our objectives. With that, I would like to make a motion to approve the food service operating agreement between Callahan Catering of Chicago and the Village of Oak Brook with respect to the Bath and Tennis Clubhouse, subject to the village manager and village attorney's final review and formally entering into that agreement prior to August 1st, 2009.
Second.
I'll second.
May I have a roll call vote, please?
Oh, we have
discussion.
We have discussion. Do we have any discussion?
No. It's a historic day.
It is.
It's been a long time
and
coming.
I think that's really a great, great step forward. Yeah. I mean, I feel you've done an excellent job.
Thank you.
So may I have a roll call vote?
Trustee Zanis?
Absolutely.
Trustee Ekipas?
Yes, of course.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Wollen?
Yes.
And that passes. The next item is the items to be removed, and we went through that. Now comes the board and commission recommendations. And that takes in McDonald's Corporation at 2111 McDonald's Drive, the zoning ordinance, Chapter 12, variations to the parking and landscape requirements to allow additional parking. Trustee Moy, would you please present the McDonald's Corporation variations request and make the appropriate motion at this time?
The Zoning Board of Appeals at its meeting on July 7th discussed this issue at length, and it's fairly complicated with a lot of variances that were necessitated because of the construction presently by IDOT at points conflicts with these parking requests by McDonald's. So I'm not going to go into each of the variances. Historically, as I understand that back in 1971, there was roughly 1,000 parking spaces around this McDonald's headquarters, and it was reduced by variance at that time down to 800 because the utilization wasn't necessary. Presently, what's happening is the Gibson's is going to be constructed on the corner just behind the McDonald's Cafe. And they will be using a considerable number of parking spaces that presently right next to the cafe and next to this McDonald's headquarters. And the space available for this parking is already there. The variances has to do with heights of shrubbery, has to do with curbside and so forth. And again, it was extensively discussed at the Zoning Board, and I find the discussion persuasive, and I would move to concur with the decision by the Zoning Board.
Thank you. Yes, Trustee Aktikas.
I suppose, are you moving to approve,
yes.
Trustee Moy?
You want to make the motion?
Yes.
Okay, I move to concur with the recommendation from the Zoning Board of Appeals approving several variations from with the attached conditions in order to construct additional parking at the McDonald's Plaza 1 building located at 2111 McDonald's Drive and authorize the village attorney to prepare the necessary ordinances for final consideration at the August 11, 2009 Board of Trustees meeting.
I will second that, and I'd like to make a couple of comments.
All right, at this point we'll have discussion. Yes.
Yes. The variance provides for an increase in the amount of parking, and also makes some allowances for reduced landscaping in the area. Now, certainly, I think there are good reasons, and McDonald's has presented good reasons to the commissions why an increase in parking in that location is necessitated based on the usage of the building. So I'm totally in support of that. And essentially, I'm in full support of the other parts of this variation and this motion. But I'd like to make two comments. First, there is an area where the corporation, McDonald's Corporation, asked for a variance in the height of the landscaping from actually the 4 that is required by ordinance to up to 2 feet for their proposal. Now, the basis for that was that the site has not yet been formulated because of the changes that are occurring. And the general impression was that actually, based on the geometry of the site, a 2-foot barrier, landscape barrier, might be adequate. However, I would like to add something here to the effect that after the geometry of the area is clearly developed, after the construction is completed, that there'll be a meeting with the village staff to review the existing conditions and to determine whether the height of the final landscaping should be 2 feet as a minimum, but up to maximum of 4 feet. And that's something that the staff could determine and that McDonald's Corporation agrees to. The other is an area that presently does not have any landscaping, and this is because actually the property, the line of the property separating McDonald's from the property owned by the state does not really allow, it's an existing condition and does not allow for any landscaping there. Certainly not any landscaping that could be placed on the McDonald property because there is parking over there. So my suggestion would be that we modify the motion by adding that the McDonald's Corporation, IDOT, and the village, at the initiative of the village, should meet to determine the feasibility of adding landscaping screening in the IDOT right of the way along this portion of 22nd Street. So we as a village should approach IDOT and see if after the construction is completed, whether IDOT will be willing to allow McDonald's to put some landscaping in that location.
Just a point comments? Of information. The reason for that, the 4-foot high shrubbery, as I understand it, is to, when cars are parked and facing the street so that the headlights of the cars do not shine into the street and cause problems with vehicles that are driving by, blinding them. The slope of the landscape here, as I understand, is already elevated several feet so that it doesn't require this whole 4 foot. And the parking spaces will be facing the McDonald's building in any case instead of facing the street. And just a point of information why they're asking a variance from the 4 foot to the 2 foot. And I think McDonald's has already mentioned at the meeting that if at the end of the day when everything is finished, it looks like they won't need more than 2 feet, they have no problem with making it 4 foot. It's just that right now, the way the land is slanted, they don't feel they need the 4 feet landscaping.
Are there any, Trustee Wolin?
Yes, I essentially agree with the points that Trustee Actipas made, but I have a question that for McDonald's, and perhaps they could address it. This 2 foot versus 4 foot, I don't quite understand it. It doesn't seem to me that it's that hard to commit to 4 feet up front. There may be a reason why you can't commit to the 4 feet up front, but the reason I asked the question is, you know, with variances, once you make a variance, then somebody else comes along and they say, well, McDonald's got it, so why don't you give it to us? So if we could get away from the variance and the 2 foot versus the 4 feet, I would prefer that. So my question is, you know, why is it that it's not possible to commit to the 4 foot right now? I mean, I can't imagine it's that much more expensive.
Well, maybe we should hear from the representative from McDonald's
right
at this point. Yes, sir, would you please state your name and who you're affiliated with, and I must remind you that we have a time limit of 5 minutes, so.
Thank you, Mr. President and Board. My name is Brendan Daly with Bollinger Lack and Associates. I prepared a lot of the materials that were in your packet, a letter to the Board dated June 30th, I believe. But the reason for the request for variation from 4 feet to 2 feet is right now, because of the work that IDOT is doing and because of the existing elevation difference between the existing parking lot and 22nd Street, we still don't know what the final landscaping is going to look like once we expand the parking lot closer to 22nd Street. The grading, as you see it now, is already roughly three to one side slope from up at McDonald's parking lot down to 22nd Street. And that area is getting tighter with the addition of the bike path and the road being widened through there. So if we, I cannot commit to 4 feet right now without a landscape plan, partially because if we did an earthen berm there, we physically can't fit a 4 foot berm in there at 3-to-1 slope and then come back down because then we're in the street. If it was something where it was a 2 foot berm and 2 foot shrub, right now we don't know what that answer is. We don't know if that's going to work into the ultimate landscaping plan. So what we were doing is preemptively asking for the variance now that if, when the landscape plan is formulated and 4 feet does not work, we don't have to come back to the board again in the spring. If 4 feet does work, then by all means, and it fits into the plan and everything else, I don't believe that McDonald's has a problem with that. However, just to stay in front of things here, because we're asking for the variation on time when we come back with a final landscape plan, because this work won't happen until the spring, you know, a little bit farther down the road from this meeting, we need to get the approval to do the parking lot expansion, and then we can, you know, spend the time and money to do the landscape plan. And it's at that point we're going to know what the final height is. So that's the reason for the request, is just to stay in front of need to come back to the board again in 2 months, 3 months, and asking for the fourth variation after the fact. That's the reason. I'm not saying on McDonald's behalf that we're trying to keep it down to 2 feet. However, a 2 foot landscape, you know, screening has already been approved at Clearwater at 22nd and York. So it's not really breaking with, you know, I believe the spirit of the ordinance, especially given the fact that you're at least 6 feet higher up in the parking lot than you are on 22nd Street. So I agree that the headlight issue is definitely not a problem here. Has that answered the question adequately?
Yes. Thank you.
And that actually was the spirit of my amendment to the motion, that whether it's going to be 2 feet or 4 feet will be determined by the village staff after the landscaping plan is presented.
Okay.
When you are ready to present that plan.
Okay.
So we will give, you know, my the idea is that you'll get a variance, but you agree that if the village staff decides that you should go up to 4 feet after the landscaping plan has been completed, then you will agree to that.
Okay.
Is there any other questions or discussion?
Did Mr. Lindemann want to speak on this? Do I remember that?
Mr. Lindemann, oh, well.
Yes.
Mr. Lindemann, did you want to come down? And
yes, I did. I did want to speak to
the... Well, wait, you got to come down, Mr. Lindemann, so we can... And I have to remind you, you used part of your 5 minutes already.
Yeah.
You're ruthless, Mr. President. You're ruthless.
Okay, while I'm passing this out, I might explain. This area is the front area where the proposed parking is the B-Road located. On the right-hand side, you'll see the existing portion of the existing six. Who's missing one?
Thank you.
Okay, you'll see that portion of the existing six spaces, and then you see the four huge trees that were planted back in the 70s, the early 70s, upon completion and construction. You'll see the four huge trees planted originally in the front of the building between 22nd Street and the building. Back in the early 70s upon completion of the building. Also at the extreme right, you'll see two very good size evergreen trees
that are in the space that is proposed to be occupied by the new parking, relocated parking. I don't know if anyone on the ZBA was aware of that. The pictures furnished by McDonald's were amateurish. I'd expect more from a kindergarten student. They were illegible. That's why the question of trees to be removed was not addressed at the ZBA. They weren't visible because of the quality of the materials provided. Secondly, there's continuing referral to headlights. Headlights are a moot point. We're talking about screening. The zoning board does not address headlights. It uses the term screening. Screening is used to block the view of unsightly objects. It may be headlights. In this case, headlights is not a not a concern. You go down the road, every car coming towards you has its headlights on, facing right toward you. Anytime someone makes a turn in front of you, their headlights cross the pass, across your eyes when they make their turn. McDonald's occupied about 10 minutes of that ZBA hearing discussing headlights. It's a moot point. It's to eliminate the view of ugly objects. In this case, ugly objects would be the front end or back end of automobiles parked in the front yard. As far as the 2 feet and 4 feet, I don't know what the concern is there, but I do know that it would be possible to lower the front end of the parking space to, in effect, increase the screening from 2 feet to 4 feet if that were necessary. No one see, the grading is pretty much finalized there. This area was never marked off for physical examination by the board or anyone else, the ZBA. Tree removal was not a term used at the ZBA meeting. And I think there's going to be a lot of people disappointed when they see those trees come down. And you people are the ones to blame. So there's a paper that I placed on in front of each of your positions there that shows the overall parking available to McDonald's. It's a huge amount of parking area available to a company that really doesn't produce a lot of retail revenue. The Village of Oak Brook is spending millions and millions of dollars to facilitate a widening of 22nd Street to improve that corridor. And it's being offset to the detriment of the village by a company that really doesn't get it as far as cooperation with the village. I mean, there are several issues which I intend to bring out regarding you know, their assessments on open space, different things that reflect negatively on their activities. And this is just an example of one of the things. A couple years ago, I know the requests on for what they call a phase one parking changes, proposed violations that you know, were later agreed to be violations of the zoning ordinance after a considerable discussion, and Bob Colleen relented on his point of view that McDonald's was in compliance. But in any case, I don't see the big rush. I think this should be run past others. I think it should be run past Hasia Levine. I think it should be run past some of the members of the Planning Commission, and I was just amazed at the lack of ingenuity, thinking out of the box displayed at the ZBA meeting. One of the issues discussed was possibly moving the parking closer to the building and moving the driveway closer to the building to allow screening along 22nd Street. Well, if you go there and look, and if you're going to cut those trees down, then there's no reason not to move the hedgerow, park the cars up against a concrete barrier. That'll give you an extra 14 feet 2 inches. Now with that 14 feet 2 inches, you move everything an additional 14 foot 2 inches. Now you have that space between the property line and where the existing, that would extend into the area of the existing driveway. That's just a simple solution. Something that someone that's being paid to perform a job should have considered. But I don't know what the reason is or why there's such eagerness to expedite something that is really their own fault. How did they feel these people were going to get to work, when they moved them to that building? Why did they never consider a parking structure? They refer to buildings that have higher ratios, 4.5 ratios. All of them have parking structures. 815 Commerce had a parking structure but was granted front parking only because the surrounding neighbors didn't want to increase the height of the parking structure. McDonald's is getting away with murder. And I think it's time to quit, but no one seems to be interested in proceeding to look out for the interests of the village. My money's being used indirectly in lieu of services. The money's being spent to widen and make a nice underpass next to McDonald's property while they're over here arguing with you over 2 feet of landscape height. I think that's ridiculous. I don't think that's a good corporate citizen whatsoever. Thank you.
Okay. By the way, did you take these pictures?
Yes, I did.
God, yes, I wish did. My wife and I had known you 50 years ago. We were getting married, and you're a great wedding.
My granddaughter saw the pictures that McDonald's presented, and she said, "Grandpa, don't they know how to take pictures in Oak Brook?" And I said, "Never mind, granddaughter. You'll find
Thank
out."
Thank you, Mr. Lindemann. You are a good photographer, I'll tell you that.
Jerry.
Yes. Trustee Wallen.
Yeah, if I could speak again. First of all, I think pretty soon we're going to have to start paying Mr. Lindemann for serving in his role as the conscience of Oak Brook. I mean, he goes to a lot of these meetings and raises a lot of good questions. The picture that he shows, which shows the trees, is kind of an eye-opening picture because it's attractive the way it looks now. It certainly is not going to be as attractive when the trees are taken down and you have the additional parking there. I would like to think there's another way to address this issue. I don't know. Mr. Lindemann suggested we send it back to the Plan Commission or Zoning Board, Bob Colleen. Is there a possibility that if we took another look at this, we could come up with some other alternatives that might be less problematic?
The issue before you is they requested variations to construct additional parking and locations that required variations, and they also sought relief to several of our landscape requirements. The village does not have regulations in place which controls or limits someone from removing or replacing vegetation on their property. So the vegetation that Mr. Lindemann brings attention to, yes, it looks nice, but it is not its removal or replacement is not violating any code. If this building were to be constructed from scratch and we were to do it all over again, as part of our PUD process, the requirement there would be not only to control the design and placement of the building, but also the type and location of landscaping. Unfortunately, this is a building that's been in existence for well over 30 years. It's my understanding that some of that landscaping is becoming overgrown. I do not know if they have plans to replace any of that. I guess that would be a question raised to McDonald's. I don't know what the benefit would be to send this back. I mean, the zoning board could comment relative to the landscaping, but it does not involve a specific code requirement. And that's the difficulty we have.
Are there any other comments to be made? Trustee Aktipas?
Mr. Address, I want to ask you, are you planning to remove all these trees, or are there any sub-provisions that could save some of them in your plan?
Unfortunately, I think it's the four locust trees that are in the front.
Yes.
Have to be removed.
All of those.
But I will tell you that they're 39 years old, and they were probably 10 to 15 years old when they were planted, and the average life of a locust tree is about 50 years. We've been continuously, you know, back pruning those trees because of the dead branches. So they're on the downswing of their life.
Is it possible when you make your changes on the site to plant some other trees there that are of a certain size and they are better suited and have a longer life expectancy? Of course, you cannot replace the size of trees that are here, but
no.
Something a little bit more mature. Certainly. Is there any space there that could?
There's space to the west of that area to shelter those mm-hmm. parking places. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, that would be certainly a long way to alleviate some of the concerns that I've heard.
Certainly.
I have a question.
Yes, Trustee Zanis.
Yes, you know, the trees are beautiful, and I certainly understand Mr. Lindemann's position, but beauty could be in a variety of different ways, for example, flowers. And McDonald's has planted beautiful flowers throughout the village. Is it possible to, in the new configuration, when you do those 2 feet of whatever it is, that, you know, maybe it's flowers, because they can add a lot of beauty as well?
You I think, read our horticulturalist mind, because he was talking about rose plants, rose bushes.
Yes.
So,
yes.
So we'll consider everything.
I know
everything.
That you have always been sensitive to aesthetics. Obviously, your work proves that. And we would encourage you to continue that focus.
We certainly will. Thank you.
You know, I'm going to have to ask Trustee Moy to read the motion again so that we can all refresh our...
I move to concur with the recommendation from the Zoning Board of Appeals, approving several variations with the attached conditions in order to construct additional parking at McDonald's Plaza 1 building, located at 2111 McDonald's Drive, and authorize the village attorney to prepare the necessary ordinances for final consideration at the August 11, 2009 Board of Trustees meeting.
And you, Trustee Moy.
And Trustee Moy, would you accept my two friendly amendments?
Could you repeat the amendments?
Sure. One will add the following condition, that the village staff will review the existing conditions upon completion of the work that is done at the site to determine the height of the final landscaping, which may be no less than 2 feet or up to maximum height of 4 feet, as determined by the village staff. That's one. And the other is that the village, with the consent of McDonald's, will enter into negotiations with IDOT to allow McDonald's to provide, to determine the feasibility of adding landscaping and screening in the IDOT right of the way along this portion of 22nd Street. Again, upon completion of the project that IDOT is carrying.
Those amendments are acceptable.
Thank you.
On that note, we've had the discussion, and I'm going to...
I have to second. I second the amendment.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. So we've had discussions. So all in favor of that, say aye.
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 Any objections? Motion carries. Now we come to unfinished business, administrative adjudication hearings. Trustee Syed was to handle this, but he's
sure
not present.
Trustee Syed actually called me about 40 minutes before the meeting. He's literally just got in town from an overseas trip and was not able to make this tonight, and I had discussions with him about tabling this. In addition, Trustee Actipas and myself and Chief Sheehan have had some discussions about some of his concerns about the information, and so my request at this point would be to ask the board to table this item.
I would be in favor of that, Mr. President. I think we need to have a clear delineation of the benefits that this changing process will have for the village, and once we're able to review that, I think we'll be in a better position to decide.
Do I have a second?
Second.
We have a roll call vote, please.
Trustee Actipas?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Mullen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Motion carries. Table. Next item is active business, confirmation of appointments. We have a Zoning Board of Appeals. So may I have a motion to approve the appointment of Natalie Capetta to the Zoning Board of Appeals?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? If not, may I have a roll call vote, please?
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Actipas?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is ordinances and resolutions. Number one, ordinance G-894, an ordinance establishing conditions for Class G liquor license and adding a Class H classification and amending Section 4-1-7 of the Village Code of the Village of Oak Brook. Attorney Sterk, would you please present the ordinance 0894?
Thank you. Well, this was just in response to an inquiry from the Illinois Liquor Control Commission because the village had separate licenses for the Bath and Tennis Club and the golf course. And as a consequence, we'd have to have the alcohol served to both sites instead of having it delivered and stored at the Bath and Tennis Club. So in order to comply with the State Liquor Control Commission's requirements, we've created one classification which will address all the sports court property.
So do I have a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Clerk Proust, may have a roll call vote, please.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Actipas?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next thing is the award of contracts, alarm board monitoring services. Trustee Moy, would you please present the alarm board monitoring services and make the appropriate motion?
Thank you, President Craig. For over 30 years, the Oak Brook has dealt with ADT systems in monitoring and servicing the alarm system. And the current agreement is up for renewal, so the village requested proposals. And proposals came in, and the best proposal appears to be from ADT. And there's good news on the horizon. The good news is that because of the new technology, we can go wireless now with a system called Mesh. And the advantage of going to wireless is that we don't have to pay AT&T for their landlines, which will result in considerable savings. It will be savings, well, the proposal by ADT will not increase their rates. First of all, they will maintain the same rates they've provided us in the past. And the proposal actually allows the village to make a considerable amount of funds. Right now, we charge $4 per alarm system that's monitored. And with the proposed system, we can increase that fee to $20 and collect $72,000 projected for the year, which is an increase of $60,000 over what we collect presently. So that's a win for the village. The second win for the village is that we don't have to pay $12,000 annual fee to AT&T for their landlines to serve this alarm monitoring service. So we're saving $12,000 a year. So it's a good deal for the village. And then on top of it, it's a good deal for the residents as well as the businesses, because their fees will go down, although slightly. Presently, they pay $94 a month for to be part of the system, and their fee under this new proposal will go down to $90. There is a one-time or installation fee, or they can lease the equipment. And on top of everything, as I understand, ADT will provide the receipt, the circuits for the city free of charge, and also reduce rates for the school district and the park district for their alarms systems. The only loser in this whole new proposal is AT&T, which will not receive almost $70,000 worth of fees that they've garnered in the past. So I have no problems moving for this contract. We do have a representative from ADT here who is, will be, I understand, will be willing to answer questions if there are any.
Do you want to come down, or are there anyone on the board that would like to or have a question? Okay, if not, is there a second to the
motion? I didn't make the motion yet.
Oh, you didn't. Oh,
okay,
sorry.
So you just went, Celios?
Second to the motion.
Oh, yeah, I was about to make the motion.
Okay.
I move that the Village Board award the contract and authorize the Village Manager to enter into an agreement with the ADT Tyco Incorporated for alarm board monitoring services pending final legal and staff review.
Second.
Okay. And is there any discussion? If not, Clerk Cruz may have a roll call vote.
Trustee Moy.
Yes.
Trustee Woolen.
Yes.
Trustee Zanis.
Yes.
Trustee Actipas. Trustee Carson.
Yes.
Contract, or the motion carries. The next item is the fire consulting contract. Trustee Moy, would you please again okay.
Well, the board has been looking into hiring a fire department consultant in order to evaluate current fire department levels of service, review the most recent fire department staffing reports, review staffing per shift, per car, overtime costs, and review the current collective bargaining agreements and so forth. I just want to precede the discussion on the consultants by saying that this move in no way comments negatively on the role that Fire Chief Tom McEllen has played in trying to save the village money. On the contrary, Tom has been working diligently and conscientiously with the board side-by-side to reduce costs at the fire department. And some of the things that Tom has already done, first of all, he moved up from the deputy fire chief position to become fire chief, and he left that position vacant, and he essentially now is doing the job of both positions, and that is saving the village an entire salary. He's eliminated a secretary position for the fire department. He's lowered the caps on the merit raise system. He's cut training budget. He's cut the budget on inspection bureau. He eliminated the Sunday driving orientation training, and he's begun to furlough battalion chiefs. And all these moves have saved the village and are saving the village hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I commend Tom for his activity. I feel we're fortunate to have him as a fire chief. However, in spite of these cuts, we feel that there may be more areas that we can find efficiency in the fire department. So Dave Niemeyer, the village manager, went out and looked for consultants that work in Illinois, so they are familiar with Illinois law and so forth, came up with two groups, the PAR group and the McGrath group. The PAR group proposed, I think, about $55,000. McGrath Group offered $22,700. And you don't always take the cheapest. You don't go to the cheapest surgeon. But in reviewing their proposals and their activity, it seems like the cheaper group has the better activity. They've reviewed the last few activities at the Village of Wilmette and also at the City of Oak Creek in Wisconsin. And both municipalities saw significant savings as a result of the consultation, and both municipalities felt that the savings more than made up for the cost of the consultation. Now, the board understands that significant cuts in fire may affect the insurance ratings for the village and would increase insurance premiums, and we would keep this in mind and try to prevent that. And the board is also aware that we don't have a lot of wiggle room for personnel because of union contracts. With these concerns in mind, the board still feels that a consulting group may provide us with some good fresh ideas to make further savings in the area of the fire. And I would invite Tom to say a few words on his thoughts in this area.
Thank you, Trustee Moy. That's correct. We've reviewed the scope of services, their qualifications, the timeliness, and their references, and they were impeccable. If we were looking at them side by side, without even looking at the price, we would recommend them. But by being half as much, it's a very easy recommendation on my part. There's nothing in the other proposal to that would justify spending additional dollars. And as long as they're thorough, fair, and competent, which they certainly have been in the past, then I would welcome their proposals.
Manager Niemeyer, would you please?
Sure. I think reiterate what the chief said. I think both firms are excellent. Both could do the job. There is a significant difference in price, but both certainly could do the job. But just to clarify one thing, when we go through this study, we don't know what the final results are going to be, but I think it would probably be premature to say that there's going to be an effect on insurance rates. We have a standard ISO rating right now, and at this point, we're not expecting any change, but I wouldn't want to say, that at this point there's going to be any change in insurance, at least at this point in time. So.
Okay.
It doesn't seem that our goal in doing this study is anything other than actually increasing efficiencies without decreasing service and finding new ways to carry out the operations in a way that it can be carried out with less commitment of money from the village. So I think that's the purpose of this. And I will move that that we approve the selection of McGrath as our choice for this particular evaluation of the fire department operation.
Well, I'll second that.
Okay. Okay. It's
all right. Clerk, is there any more discussion? If not, may I have a roll call vote, please?
Trustee Wollen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Aktipas?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
The motion carries. The next item is the police and fire consolidation discussions. As some of you may know or some of you may not know, Manager Niemeyer and myself met with the mayors of Hinsdale, Clarendon Hills, and Burr Ridge. And our purpose was to find out if we could somehow consolidate services and among the various towns. And as you probably realize, right now we have a mutual agreement that everyone participate in helping others in fire problems. So I'm going to ask Manager Niemeyer to give us a little update, and then I'm going to ask for a motion to authorize the village manager, Niemeyer, and I to continue discussions with the Burr Ridge, Hinsdale, and Clarendon Hills on the fire consolidation and police, and to bring back information to the village board on updates and the next steps.
Sure. Thanks, President Craig. I think you gave a good summary of the direction we're going. This meeting was actually initiated by the village of Hinsdale. Obviously, you know, in Oak Brook, we know the challenges that we've been facing budget-wise, and certainly all the communities around here are doing it. And I want to emphasize, you know, I think at this point, what this is exploratory discussions. You know, I think it's certainly incumbent upon us as the village board and the staff to certainly look at all opportunities to try to do things better. This may be an opportunity, may not be an opportunity to do things a little bit differently. But at this point, we had a very general discussion. Is it worth having some future meetings to discuss the idea of sharing services for police and or fire? And after at the end of that meeting, the four mayors and managers agreed to all go back to their trustees and at this point get a consensus to continue that discussion. Again, this is a long-term process. Certainly should not deter us from the work that we just voted on, the fire consultant, and I know there's also a desire, I think, to do a similar analysis of police, because I mean our hope is that analysis will develop some more short-term savings, and this is a little bit longer-term process. But I would ask the board if they would consider a motion to recommend continued general discussions with Burr Ridge, Hinsdale, and Clarendon Hills on the sharing of resources in police and fire, and then report back to the board on updates and information. And finally, I do want to say, however we proceed with this thing, this will be something that there will be public discussion, public input, public debate if it gets to that point, and it will be a long-term process.
I will move that the village president and the village manager continue to pursue discussions for the possibility of working together with neighboring communities to improve to enter into a cooperation arrangement to improve the costs of to improve services and decrease the cost for the village.
I'll second.
Any discussion?
I have a couple questions. Would this affect the taxpayers at all, our Oak Brook residents, as far as would there be a line item for taxing for fire or police district? Or is the vision that our residents would not be encumbered with a tax?
I think at this point it's premature to say what the outcome would be, whether or not there would be. I think if you're implying would there be a district, we haven't got to that discussion. There's other ways to share services besides creating a new taxing district. I mean, there's intergovernmental agreements that can be done. I think the question you're asking is that could a recommendation out of this be to create a district? We just have had one meeting on it and it hasn't gotten to that point. So I would not want to say today, you know, that anything is off the table, I guess.
And is the vision 2010, 2011, 2012, do we have any idea?
We did not have those type of discussions. This was kind of a preliminary, about an hour meeting, and I think we all felt if there wasn't a consensus among the governing bodies to move forward, there wasn't much sense in doing anything else. So I think we would now get back together, decide how we want to proceed. Some towns that have looked at these consolidation efforts, and I got to say, there's not a lot of nationwide models for it, but towns that have done this have often hired a consultant to help bring them along, and that, you know, that could be a step that we would look at. And I think at that point we would say, you know, here's some of the options we're looking at, here's the expected timetable, and we'd be able to give you some of the detail to some of the good questions you're asking. So.
Well, let me just say, you want to...
Last one. In terms of effort, is this an hour a month, or is this 5 hours a week for you?
At this point, we haven't really started, other than this hour meeting. I think it would depend on how it depends on how quickly the boards want to do and how much they want to do. Until we kind of map out the scope of what we want to do, I don't know.
Actually, what we're talking about is mutual aid, and I don't think there's any consideration of some tax or anything. That wasn't even mentioned.
I wouldn't want to spend a lot of time and effort on something that's going to result in a tax for our residents. I guess that's my point.
I'm definitely
so,
against that.
You know, I would add a friendly amendment that says as long as taxing our residents is not part of the...
But mutual aid can be, you know, can happen just as we have it now. We can expand our mutual aid among other communities. It doesn't have to be just Clarendon Hills, Hinsdale. We can do it with Oak Brook Terrace and the York Fire Protection District and things like that.
Well, if Trustee Zanis had not added the friendly amendment, which I certainly accept, I would have added it myself. I think the purpose of this is to save money, make the operation more effective, cut from our budget operations, not impose another tax.
No, not at all.
Then I second.
Okay.
I think it already has been seconded. Sorry.
Someone seconded.
I second it.
Sorry.
Okay. May I have any more discussion, questions? If not, have a roll call vote, please.
Trustee Aktipas?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Maury?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Next item is the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund. Trustee Aktipas, would you present the IMRF
Thank
contribution
you,
issue and make the appropriate motion?
Thank you, President Gregg, and I will do so in a moment in terms of a motion. But I would like, in the interim, to ask Village Manager to present you a couple of options. What I have in front of me are his recommendations, and I want him to directly give you his thoughts of how we should proceed with at what level we should proceed of payments to the fund.
Okay, thank you, as Trustee Aktipas. One of our favorite subjects again, pensions. And tonight's discussion is on the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund. We've had previous discussions on police and fire. This is a very different funding mechanism than police and fire, mainly because. The IMRF is also, like police and fire, was battered by last year's drop in the stock market, actually battered quite a bit more because they have a higher allocation in equities and other investments. But they have a funding system that essentially phases in increases over a number of years. So the increase actually you see is even though their losses were greater, is not nearly as onerous as the 30% and 35% contributions that we had for police and fire. But really what you have in front of you is three options. And to back up a little bit, we're really actually talking about two different plans. We're talking about IMRF, which has 115 active employees. Then there's a program called SLEP, Sheriff's Law Enforcement Program, which has one active member. And essentially what we've given you is three options with different contribution rates. And again, this is not for 2009. This is for the 2010 budget. So this would not have any effect as we're trying to close the differences in the budget this year. The most aggressive option in terms of an increase would be option one, 12.31% for regular members and 14.35% for SLEP. The second one would be a less aggressive plan of 11.3% and for IMRF and 12.96 for SLEP. And then option three would be, you know, somewhere in the middle. Option two would be a savings of about $15,275 from option one, and then option three obviously would be somewhere in the middle. The staff's opinion, the staff recommendation, is to go with a more aggressive rate, option one of 12.31% for IMRF and 14.35% for SLEP. By selecting this, we would reduce our unfunded balance more quickly than either of the other two options. We have until the end of the month, until the end of August, to choose the rate, and if not, we would essentially be selected to go into the less aggressive rate.
Thank you, David. I'm in agreement, actually, with the recommendation of our village manager. I believe we should move with a more aggressive option, and therefore I will make the following motion, that the village board select option one, the ARC, which is the annual required contribution, employer rate at 12.31% for regular members and 14.35% for SLEP, which is just one employee. I think that the impact on choosing this plan will be a little higher for us for the 2010 budget, but we have already taken measures and will continue to take measures to balance our 2010 project quite aggressively. So I don't anticipate that the difference between option one, two, or three is something that we cannot handle adequately. On the other hand, I think it makes it possible for us to keep up with the losses that have occurred on that fund.
Do I have any discussion?
Second, you need
second.
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 Now, do we have any discussion? If not, would ask for a roll call vote, please.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Wallen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Ektufis?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is the Oak Brook Terrace Street Lighting Agreement with the Street Lighting Beautification Program Update. Trustee Ektufis, would you please update the board on the street lighting agreement with the Street Lighting Beautification Program and make the appropriate motion?
Thank you very much, President Craig. As you probably recall, the village board, going back a few months, or actually several months, decided that it should undertake a program for beautification of the village that involved a number of elements, and among these elements was a plan to increase the lighting and use special lighting for the 22nd Street west of Route 83 and in between. So now, as you probably all recall, we were successful. The village was successful to see the $20 million that is necessary for improvements to be made and the widening of 22nd Street to come to pass, and therefore now we have the funding, and we have the cooperation of the IDOT to proceed with this project pretty expeditiously. So at this moment we are called to make a decision as to whether we want to commit the funds that are necessary to add special lighting for the 22nd Street, special lighting that will cost above and beyond what the state will approve for the lighting of the area. There are three options that the staff has offered, actually, Mike Hullihan, the director of our public works, for our consideration. One would involve actually the village's commitment to obtain special lighting, and that will result in a cost of about $1.2 million, with the assumption that actually another $500,000 would be contributed by the village of Oak Brook Terrace. The second option would be to delete the lighting enhancement as part of the IDOT 22nd Street improvement. And that actually will involve a very minimal cost of $15,000 for redesigning the lighting to conform to actual IDOT standards that IDOT then will provide. And the third option would be to delete the enhancement as part of the IDOT 22nd Street improvement, but actually take some measures now when the street is going to be under construction to create some infrastructure that would possibly help us in the future if we decide when times get better and the cows are fat again whether at that time we would want to add this type of lighting in on 22nd Street. And that would involve about $15,000 to redesign the lighting system and about approximately $75,000 to install the conduit and the infrastructure for the project to take place sometime in the future, if that will be the case. I will make a motion to actually take option two, which is to delete the lighting enhancement as part of the IDOT 22nd Street improvement project, which will result only in approximately $15,000 cost to redesign the lighting to conform to IDOT standard. I will make that motion for the purpose of discussion. I would not be entirely opposed to option three, which will make it possible for us to revisit the project again at a future time, when better times are with us. But generally speaking, we have to understand that by adding this new lighting system, we are making a commitment that is actually a larger commitment than the $1.7 million that are involved if we make that commitment in the future, because essentially by doing that, we are changing the standards for lighting throughout the village, and we will have to be prepared for additional costs of over another million, maybe a million and a half in the future, to change all our lighting and make it consistent. So, as I said, I'm moving to take option two for the purpose of discussion, and I will leave it at that for the moment.
Oh, I'm sorry, Trustee Wallen.
It's okay. Thank you, President Craig. I'm glad that Trustee Aktipas is open to option three, because I think that is the logical option to go with at this point in time. While they're tearing up the road, and keep in mind we're tearing up 22nd Street from Route 83 to where it meets Butterfield, about a mile and a half, maybe 2 miles. While they're tearing the road up, this is the ideal time to put the conduit in, so if at a later date we desire to have lighting, it'll be fairly inexpensive. While they're tearing up the road, we're going to know where all the utilities are. If at a later date we have to go back and do it, it's going to be very expensive to redo it. If you put the conduit in, you know, I've had discussions with our Public Works Director, Mike Coulihan, and Village Manager. There is also the possibility that you could actually rent that conduit out for some number of years, because there are cable companies that are desirous of having cables. And option three would give us that capability. I'm in favor of option three. I'm not betting on the fact that we're going to rent it out, but it's something that if we approve it, we should definitely pursue. I took a survey of streetlights in this area. First of all, the area that we're talking about, I didn't realize it, does not have streetlights. If you go west of Route 83, 80% of that area does not have streetlights. At some point in time, not only for purposes of beautification, but also for purposes of safety, it may be desirable to have streetlights. So my recommendation is that we proceed to spend the $100,000 or whatever it turns out to be. We don't have a firm estimate on it. If it turns out to be $500,000, forget it. But I think we should proceed to talk to IDOT, see what the actual estimates are, and if it's reasonable, proceed with the conduit. What I would do is I would pay for the conduit on the south side of the street, and if Oak Brook Terrace wants one on the north side, they should be expected to pay for the entire thing. So I would urge the council to or the board to consider option number three.
Yes, Trustee Carson.
Just a question. What would be the source of funding for this, Dave? At whatever level, whether it's at the 1.2 million plus or 75 or 15,000?
It's out of our infrastructure fund that's funded by the 0.5% sales tax that we can only use for infrastructure projects. So, and this, the 1.7 is in the budget. 1.6, I think, so.
I would comment that I'd be more inclined to go with option three then as well, just for planning. Keep that option, the option to do different lighting in the future, open to us.
Any other discussion?
Yes, I do have some questions.
Sure.
I don't know who to ask. Maybe Dale. How many linear feet are we talking about in Oak Brook versus Oak Brook Terrace for this improvement?
It's roughly half. All of the right-of-way of 22nd Street from 83 to almost to Midwest Road is in Oak Brook Terrace, and all of the right-of-way from that point to Butterfield is in Oak Brook. So it's roughly 50-50.
So is there a reason why Oak Brook Terrace didn't want to split the bill 50-50?
It was a project initiated by us. We have a lot more sales tax-producing businesses. That was probably the major reason why.
And we are still doing the water main?
Yes.
And that's all 100% our expense? Oak Brook Terrace is not contributing to that?
Yeah, that's 100% ours. So.
Mm-hmm. And this, we would, if we do option three, do we get the streetlight credit? This $296,000 credit, would we still get that?
No.
No. Okay.
Does that mean that our actual cost then would be?
Would be much more than.
Much more than $100,000?
Well, it would be the loss of the 296, right? That would just fall into a hole
right.
somewhere.
Yeah, yeah.
Plus the $75,000.
Yeah.
Right. Of which.
The 296 reduces the over. The reason why it's 1.7 is because of the 296. It would be, correct me if I'm wrong, about 2 million if it wasn't for that.
1.9, I think, was the estimate.
Okay, right, right. So that wouldn't be added to our cost. That would just go away. So.
If we were to do nothing, they would have spent $300,000 on IDOT street right. lighting. Now it'll cost us another roughly $15,000 to go back to that point.
So if we do nothing, they're going to spend their $300,000 in whatever fashion they see fit. We're going to spend $75,000 to put in the conduit. And in 5 years, if we want to do it, we will have to take out their $300,000 worth. Or would that stay?
Those lights probably would be removed to make the whole corridor similar.
Well, would you give consideration to asking Oak Brook Terrace if they would consider renegotiating and splitting the cost 50-50, in which case I would consider going forward and at least realizing the benefit of the $300,000.
I guess, so you're saying if they were willing to split the cost. 850-850, the board would contribute 850 towards it?
Well, I think that would be a more equitable split.
Okay.
And then we both realize the benefit of the $300,000. And we get the job done now.
Okay.
I mean, these are times where if we could save $300,000, why not have that conversation?
So, Trustee Zenis, are you proposing that we move forward with committing the entire amount of money?
No.
No, not at this time. Oh. I don't think.
Okay. No, I was going to suggest the possibility of directing the village manager to have a conversation with them and see if they would consider splitting the cost with us on a 50-50 basis. If so, then at our next meeting, I think we should move forward with approving the lighting. We will have saved a couple hundred thousand.
We'll just table it now, maybe.
Yeah. I mean, we have nothing to lose, right?
I would be a little hesitant to make this kind of commitment of funding for decorative lights while the village is still having tremendous financial obligations for finishing the bridge. And we have to be concerned how we would pay for that on the long term.
Mm-hmm.
So I would hate to make such a major commitment at this
Even
point.
Even at 850?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. In that case, I would be supportive of option number three.
So,
needs to be a motion for.
When you realize that could be a
motion. I will move then. I will change my motion to accept option number three.
I'll second the change.
May I have a roll call vote?
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Ektepis?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is the Autumn Festival budget for 2009. Trustee Woolen, would you please present the Autumn Fest?
Yes, thank you, President Craig. We have some representatives of Autumn Fest that have been very patiently sitting here tonight, and they're here if we have any questions. They have worked diligently over the past few months. They've got a nice Autumn Fest plan for September, what is the date? September 20th, I think. September 20th? Okay. They have worked out, as they always do, a series of very nice activities for the kids to enjoy. They have a total budget of $3,848. And the best news of all is they have done a great job in fundraising. And they have raised enough money to fund these activities. There's also the possibility they could get a little bit of additional money. And if they do, it'll be even that much better of an Autumn Fest. So I congratulate the committee on doing a very fine job. And I move to approve the budget for the 2009 Autumn Festival as recommended by the Autumn Festival Committee pursuant to Village Board Resolution R-1000.
Second.
Do I have any discussion? If not, roll call vote, please.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Ektepis?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
All right, that motion passes. Then we have the information and updates from the village manager.
Thanks, President Craig. Well, I have a minor piece of good financial news since we're always talking about gloom and doom here. But in front of you is a memo from the fire chief. If you remember right, several months ago we had put our old engine 912 out for sale. We had actually put in our budget an expectation of about $60,000 in sale proceeds, and the chief informed me today that BP Apparatus has given us an offer of $81,000 for that engine. So barring any concerns from the board, we'll move forward with accepting that right away. So that's all I have.
The next, it would be Clerk Pruce.
I just wanted to remind everybody, tomorrow is the buffet at the Oakbrook Bath and Tennis. Last week, there was hardly a seat open. So I hope everybody has their reservations. And you still can come tomorrow morning and or call and make your reservations. Remember, it's from 11:30 to 1:30. Thank you.
The next item is the trustees.
I have a question. Do we need to take formal action in order for you to sell that fire engine? Should we make a motion?
Basically, I think there was authorization to sell that. I don't think there. I mean, if the board wants to do that, that's fine. But I mean,
wasn't this already discussed?
It was.
And
it was the board. The board basically authorized it to go.
Yeah, we did. In the past.
Yeah.
Agreement.
Right.
Okay.
Next is the trustees. Do any trustees have any information or?
I would just like to comment that our tennis program is becoming very vibrant this year with our new coach, and I think there are some interesting events coming up, you know, competitive events and social events as well. I encourage anyone who plays tennis to please join in. We've certainly accomplished one of our goals to improve our tennis program at the B&T. That'll be at least for the summer, and then after summer, you know, we'll be planning for next year. And it's possible, you know, that our coach will extend the season to the best of his ability, with weather permitting. Thank you.
Okay.
President Craig?
Yes.
there are a couple of items that I want to share with the board. Since we got today information regarding both of these items, both are good items. One relates to the fact that Gibson's has already applied for a building license, and we anticipate that the building will be built quickly, and it will be done by end of this year. Gibson has a wonderful operation, a very successful steak chain, and we expect them to contribute very positively to our sales taxes in the village. So that's something to celebrate among all the grim news we receive every day. The other item I would like to mention is we did get notification today from the village manager that the light at Costco has been approved by the state. And I like to pay tribute to Trustee Zenis for two reasons. First, because she was the one who really made the contact with the village of Oak Brook Terrace, and she continuously put the effort to persuade the board and the mayor that it would be to everybody's best interest to keep Costco in the area. And she was successful in convincing them, which made it possible then for us to get the approval from the IDOT. The other part in which also Trustee Zenis contributed was our visit to Springfield along with Dr. Moy, when we made contact with the IDOT, and we got the IDOT's commitment to approve this light once the village of Oak Brook Terrace would give its consent. So I think that's another very good item of news, because that light is instrumental for keeping Costco in place. Costco for many, many months, if not years, has been concerned about access to their parking lot. I think we have addressed their problems, and also probably we are instrumental as a result of these things in improving their sales, and in that respect we'll benefit. So those are some positive news that we can celebrate today. Yes.
I think it's interesting to add that Costco will pay for that light.
Yes.
And to put in a stoplight, I understand, costs up about $250,000, which raised my eyebrow, because I didn't realize a stoplight would cost that much. But with the engineering and the wiring and all that, but in any case, Costco was willing to foot the bill for that instead of the village.
Well, thank you for the compliment, and it was good work.
Well deserved.
It was good work.
And I think that's well deserved.
Thank you.
The only comment I have, and I'd like to close with this, is that this entire board has a goal of ending 2009 in the black. And that has been a difficult project, but we're working along those lines. And I can tell you that, and I don't want anyone to get the idea, well, we have all this money. We have increased our reserves to $9 million. As of June, we added $150,000. And I intend to see that reserve, because that's a six-month reserve for this village. And we, you know, it's like an old story. It's a bank account. And if you don't put money in and keep taking out, you would have nothing at the end. And it's like friendship and everything else. But this village, under this board, will continue to keep our focus, and that's to keep this village in the black at the end of 2009, and to prevent any talk about, someone said, a local levy. We don't want to even hear that. So I think it's my goal, and it's the goal of everyone sitting up here. And we're doing just that. And on that note, may I have a motion to adjourn to a closed meeting to consider the appointment, the employment, the compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the public body or legal counsel for the public body, including hearing testimony on a complaint lodged against the employee of the public body or against legal counsel for the public body, to determine the validity, 2C1, to discuss collective negotiating matters between the public body and its employees of their representatives, or deliberations concerning salary schedules for one or more classes of employees, 2C2, and to discuss minutes of meetings lawfully closed under the Open Meetings Act. whether for the purpose of approval by the body of the minutes or for the semiannual review of the minutes as required by the Open Meetings Act 2C21. Is there a second?
Second.
The motion.
Pardon? Well, may I have the motion to that effect?
So moved.
Second.
Is there any discussion? If not, Clerk Bruce may have a roll call meeting. roll call vote, please.
Trustee Aktipas?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
9:30.
The meeting is adjourned.